Companies worldwide grappled on Friday with what Troy Hunt famously described as the largest IT outage in history. Here are some of the stats. 8.5 million Windows devices stopped working. 28,000 flights delayed. 4,000 flights canceled. And with that, hospitals like UVA Health in Virginia and Mass General Brigham in Boston went offline. Clinics shut down. Surgeries were canceled. FedEx reported substantial disruptions. UPS was impacted as well. Waitrose, Co-op Grocery in the UK, lost their payment systems. Only cash could be accepted. Starbucks mobile app went offline. Tesla halted its production. And at one of Amazon's distribution centers, the paid staff passed their time singing karaoke because no one could work. The cause of all this was a faulty sensor configuration update that got pushed to Microsoft by the cybersecurity giant CrowdStrike. But what was the bug exactly? Insiders surely know by now, but even we can guess. A top suspect is buffer overflow. That would cause a fatal error because overflowing buffer might directly overwrite critical memory, leading to an immediate crash. And that could happen if the code didn't check the size of incoming data properly before writing to memory. Another top suspect is null pointer dereferencing. That would also cause a fatal error because if memory is accessed by a resource that points to an invalid memory location, then the system will try to reach for non-existing data, and that would lead to an immediate crash. And that could certainly happen as part of a process like sensor configuration update, which is what this was. And here are 10 other situations that also might have caused the blue screen of death. By whatever path, CrowdStrike stock is now down a full one-third from earlier this month, which represents a $31 billion loss in market capitalization for the company, which might not be an overreaction. So that was a very expensive software bug. In response, CEO George Kurtz wrote, "We understand the gravity of the situation and are deeply sorry for the inconvenience." To which Jim Cramer of CNBC replied, "An apology means that you are culpable. Therefore, you will be sued." Here are side-by-side pictures of George Kurtz before and after the blue screen crisis. As of today, the poor guy looks like he saw a ghost. Even his hair is standing straight up. Suffice to say, you and I do not want to be a future incarnation of this poor guy, who only last week was the darling of Wall Street, and today seems irrevocably fated to go down in history forever as the guy who was at the helm when CrowdStrike deployed code that created the largest IT outage in world history. So, let's focus now on lessons learned. Today, I have as my very special guest, Dave Stern, who's a fractional CTO and senior solutions architect at Stern DevOps Group. He's also the author of the recent best-selling book, Hackproof Your Startup. Dave, thank you very much for joining me today.
Thank you, Jim.
So tell me, we don't know too much yet about what happened, but we have been told that a content update was pushed that it affects only Windows, that it was quickly realized that it was an issue and it was pulled back, but we also know that by then it was too late for many users because once you have a blue screen, then you can't push updates anymore. So this turned out to be pretty catastrophic. What, based upon what you know, what might have been done differently in order to avoid this?
Great question. I think that's, you know, the focus is looking forward. A lot of people are focusing on the fact that this was a bug. And in software deployment, you know, with our clients, we typically do cloud deployments, but the methodology is very, very similar in that you hope for the best and you expect the worst. So if you're prepared, all software has bugs. Like, you know, anybody who's released anything has released bugs to users. It happens. So you have to plan for that. In a situation like this, and by analogy, you know, we may not be deploying to a Windows system or a system where it is completely locked up. And when you reboot it, you have to do a manual. My understanding is you have to delete a file manually or whatever. Many of us are not in that situation, but we are in situations where we're deploying soft critical, mission critical software to end users, potentially in the thousands or millions. So number one, setting up your CI/CD process, your continuous integration, continuous deployment, your release process correctly so that you have testing environments which are working all throughout the process so that you can fail at any point if something isn't working. And then doing rollouts like canary deploys, which is a deploy where you roll out to a very small subset of users and you make sure that things are working correctly. Do we roll out pieces of it and put it behind feature flags? Do we roll out the whole thing to a canary or a test subset where we do 100 out of 10,000 users? But planning for that is the critical piece.
So, Dave, tell me more about canary, because I kind of understand it. It sounds like the concept is canary in the gold mine, where you stick the canary down there, and then if it dies, then you don't send the coal miners down there because there's not enough oxygen. That sounds like what that is. Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Sure. And it's not, none of this is brain surgery. It's setting up your deploys, and most modern deployment systems that you use, whether it's GitHub Actions or GitLab or Jenkins or, you know, any of the other popular CI or CD solutions, there's a way to set it to say, let's deploy this. You do have to have good monitoring and good alerting to know if something went wrong. But to deploy to a very small subset of users, you can hand pick that subset. Maybe they're beta testers, maybe they're forgiving customers. If you're big enough and you have, let's say, you know, a million users, then you could just pick a random subset of 20,000, right? So you're deploying to 2%, and then you're seeing what's happening with those accounts. You have good monitoring in place. You have dashboards. You have alerts where you can say, okay, this feature is supposed to work this way. Based on the metrics, is it working the way that we expect? And hopefully some of those users are internal as well, so they can play with the feature and make sure that it works the way you expect. That's all it is, just deploy to a very small subset of users. And then from that point, you can either do a phased rollout where you go, say, 10% at a time, or you can say, okay, this looks good, let's just roll it out to everybody else. And both are valid depending on how mature your organization is or your technical team is.
Yeah, good. So, Dave, thank you very much for this insight. It really means a lot to me, and I know to the people that are listening. Can you tell me a little bit about how people can get in touch with you if they have any follow-up questions in regard to what you were telling us today?
Yeah, thank you very much. My website is sterndevopsgroup.com. There's a contact form there, so you can, or you can email me. There's information on the website. So yeah, and I'd be happy to speak to anybody that thinks they have issues in this regard.
Okay. Super, Dave. Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Well, that was excellent. For me, the key takeaway is that little canary in the coal mine, ensuring that there's a low-risk early warning system or an indicator of danger ahead, enabling preventive corrective action in place of apologies. And building on that, here are some famous sayings about this same idea for all of us to ponder. Meanwhile, thanks for watching and see you next time.